of heaven. The pursuit of heaven, part 5, we call it heaven pursuit. The Bible said of a place called heaven and another place called hell. And the destiny of every human being will be one of these two places. Either heaven to spend eternity with God, or hell, a place of separation from God. It is my prayer that our destiny will be heaven in Jesus' name, where we shall spend our eternity with God the Almighty, a place of peace and enjoyment. Heaven pursuit is when believers focus on heaven. When we focus on heaven, when we have desire to do everything to please God, it is a pursuit of peace with God. Heaven pursuit is a quest for heaven. When we have that desire, when we pant after heaven as deer pants after the water brooks, it is to please God. Who God, who we have to do. You do not belong to this world, and so our citizenship is in heaven. Tell somebody, your citizenship is in heaven. So let us focus on where we belong. Our real destiny is heaven. This world does not own us anything. We belong to God. And so let us try as much as possible to focus on heaven. You see how athletes quest for gold, how they put in all their best, how they run and they focus, they don't take, side to side attractions or wait around to please somebody, but they focus. So we should do the same thing. We should put in our best for gold. We should follow all the rules and the regulations so that at the end of it all, we have a place of peace with God. Now, journey to heaven, Apostle Paul explained in 2 Timothy chapter 4 from verse 7 to 8. Now, journey to heaven, Paul sees it, he looks at it as a fight. But it's a good fight. Apostle Paul looks at this as a race. A race. So, if we are really serious of spending our eternity with God, then we have to fight this good fight of faith. We have to run this race to a conclusive end, and we must keep our faith, whatever will happen on the way. 2 Timothy 4:7 to 8, I have fought the good fight, Paul said at the end of his race. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And he said, finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. So at the end of this race, at the end of this battle that we are fighting, devil planning to sidetrack us, to ambush us, to destroy our faith, when we eventually finish this battle, this fight, this good fight, when we eventually finish this race, Apostle Paul said, finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous God, will give to me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. So it's for everybody. Everyone that keeps this race, everyone that fights this battle, everyone that focuses on heaven, everyone that has given his or her life to Jesus Christ, at the end of this race, we will all be rewarded. Amen.
Amen.
So today, this morning, I group this into A, B, C. So A, you just have to walk. You just have work visa. You do not have any citizenship in this world. All of us, we are here temporarily. We just have permit to work. This is not our home. So we have to handle this place as a temporary place, and we have to pursue heaven. It is my prayer that we shall understand this, and we will make effort to make changes. Let us pursue heaven. Look at this world as a temporary place, as a place that you have just come here to visit and focus on your eternal home. Philippians chapter 3, 20 to 21. You know, remember that popular message, resident alien. Where is your citizenship? We are all resident aliens in this place. Our citizenship is in heaven. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself. So where is our citizenship? It's in heaven. Christians must know this, and they must live their life in accordance with that belief that our citizenship is in heaven. It won't be long when we shall leave this place. Look at the great men and women in the hall of faith. People like Abel, Enoch, Noah, Sarah, Moses, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all these people. The Bible recorded that with all that they have done, to even qualify them to be in the hall of faith, they did not receive the promise in this world. Because God has something better for them in heaven. Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews 11 from verse 13. These all died in faith, all these people. Abel, Enoch, Noah, Sarah, these people died in faith, not having received the promises. You see how amazing it is? But having seen them afar off, were assured of them, all the promises. Because God sees that the issue of heaven is a permanent issue, and more importance is attached to the issue of heaven. Every other thing is just, you know, temporary. So God is not, you know, making so much, you know, emphasis on those temporary things. Because they will soon come and go. He said, embrace them and confess that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. So these people, all these people in the hall of faith, they live their life as strangers and pilgrims on the earth. So God was promising them this, promising them that, promising them this, but they did not look at those things as permanent. They did not look at this world as a permanent place. So they regarded themselves as strangers and pilgrims in this world. So they pursue heaven. So we will take this example too. Let's look at this their example and pursue heaven, and look at yourself in this place as a stranger. As a stranger and a pilgrim. Verse 14. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Where is our homeland?
Heaven.
Heaven. Homeland security. Our homeland is heaven. Amen?
Amen.
You know, after 9/11, they have to change they have to establish another ministry or another department in the US that they call it Homeland Security. Because they want to secure homeland. So they put emphasis in securing homeland. Amen?
Amen.
Can we also secure our homeland? Let us also secure our homeland. Heaven is our homeland. Let us pursue the issue of our homeland. They seek a homeland. And truly, if they had come to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. But now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. They desire heavenly country. Christians must desire heaven. They must desire something that is better, something that is permanent, something that is peaceful. Homeland, heaven. We must desire like these people. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, because they know they're going to spend their eternity with him. So they are not ashamed to call God their God. For he has prepared a city for them. God had prepared what for us? A city and homeland. God had prepared for us heaven. So don't let us waste all this effort to return us back home. Check out what Apostle Peter wrote to God's chosen people. Look at what Peter said, pertaining to heaven. Heaven pursuit. We must focus on heaven. We must focus on what is permanent. We must focus on what is gainful. We must focus on something that cannot be destroyed. 1 Peter chapter 1, let me read from verse 1. I, Peter, he said, I am writing this letter. I am an apostle of Jesus Christ. I am sending this letter to you, God's chosen people. Where are God's chosen people? We, all of us, every Christian, we are God's chosen people. You are strangers in the world. Every God's chosen people is a stranger in this world. You may not want to take this, you may not want to accept it, you may not want to, you know, believe it, but let me tell you why we are strangers here. All of us, we do not know what can happen in the next 1 hour. We don't know, all of us, because we're strangers here. We're all strangers here. This is about 12:20 p.m. Chicago time. We don't know what will happen in 12:30. We don't know. This is 12:30. In the next 10 minutes, we don't know. That's why we are strangers. We cannot look at this place as somewhere that is permanent. No, we are all strangers, all of us. We are strangers in this world. Say, God's chosen people, you are strangers in the world. You are strangers in the world. I want to stop there. That's what Peter said, Apostle Peter. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, listen to this one now. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, you automatically become fellow citizens of heaven. Automatically, your status must change. Immediately you give your life to Jesus Christ, your status must be adjusted. You don't need to apply. There's no need for application to adjust your status. You become citizen of heaven as soon as you are giving your life to Jesus Christ, because Jesus paid it all. Jesus died for us on the cross of Calvary. If you have chosen to live your life with Him in eternity, if you have accepted Him to your life as your personal Lord and Savior, your status will be adjusted immediately. You confess Jesus as Lord and Savior, and you promise to follow Him the rest of your life. Hello? You do not need to apply for adjustment of status. God will automatically adjust it. It's a covenant that cannot be broken. It's a covenant that is banded by the blood of Jesus Christ shed on the cross of Calvary. Are you listening to me? Very simple. I want to congratulate you because we are a Christian, because we are born again. At the end of it all, you have a place of peace with God. Amen.
Amen.
Congratulations. But look at this one also. For those that refuse Christ, hello, their status is also adjusted to become citizens of a place called Lake of Fire. Those who refuse Christ, those who don't accept Christ, their status will change automatically. That after they will have departed this body, they will spend their eternity in a lake of fire, hell, where they will be conscious forever. Eternity. It's serious. Let's take this serious. Revelation 20. Revelation 20 from verse 10. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. Verse 12. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books,
The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Now listen to me very carefully. So we have two choices to make. Either we choose to spend our eternity with Christ, in which your physical status will be adjusted. When I was explaining the theology of our final destination, I said our father and mother fell in the Garden of Eden, and they were separated from God. The Bible recorded that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. For anyone now who will have to come back to God, Jesus purposely came for that cause, and he died on the cross of Calvary. He paid the final price. He did it all. Now, the state that we have, our status, before Christ died for us, our status, before accepting Christ into our lives as personal Lord and Savior, our status is doomed. If we depart this world with that offer, it will continue, and that doomed status will be permanent. But if we accept the offer Jesus gave on the cross of Calvary, automatically that status will be adjusted, and then we will have a place with God in heaven. Then such a person's name will be written in the book of life. Do you hear it now? Such a person's name, the one whose status has been adjusted from the status of doom, from the status of destruction, from the status of separation from God, that person's status will be adjusted, and his name will be written in the book of life. For anyone who lives in this world, listen very carefully, who refused to accept that offer that Jesus gave on the cross of Calvary to die for us, such a person's status will remain not adjusted from that doomed status, that temporary doomed status. Now, such a person's status, after finally leaving this place without Christ, will be adjusted and turned to permanent. Do you understand that? Will be adjusted and turned to permanent, which means that such a person's name is not in the book of life. And for anyone whose status has not been adjusted to have accepted Jesus as personal Lord and Savior, to spend eternity with him in heaven, such a person's name will not be in the book of life. For everyone whose status has been adjusted and accepted Jesus, his name will be in the book of life. But listen, for anyone whose name is not found in the book of life, such a person will be thrown into that lake of fire where hell and Hades were thrown. And it is called the second death. Verse 15. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Hello?
Amen.
That will not be your destiny in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Your name that has been written in the book of life will not be blotted out.
Amen.
B. The Bible advises us to set our minds on things that are above. If we are really pursuing heaven, we have to focus and set our minds on things that are above. That was why Apostle Paul called it a good fight, a race. When you are running a race, you set your mind, you focus. You don't look here, you don't look there. People will be sharing you, they will be waving their hands. Some people will be making guests of you. You don't look at all those people. You focus, you face the business, you quest for gold. The Bible is also saying we should do the same thing. Set your mind on heaven. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 to 2. Colossians 3, 1 to 2. If we are really pursuing heaven, we must set our mind on things that are above. If then you are raised with Christ, he your status has been adjusted to spend your eternity with Christ. Adjusted to be citizens of heaven. If truly speaking, your status has been adjusted to be citizens of heaven, seek those things which are above, where Christ is. Sitting at the right hand of God, set your mind on things above, not on things on the heart. Christians, are we listening now?
Yes, sir.
This is God's word. I didn't write this. If we are born again, if we are Christian, if your status has been adjusted to spend your eternity with Christ, the Bible is telling you here, Colossians 3:1-2, to set your mind on things above. 2 Corinthians 4:18. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. We have to set our mind on heaven. We don't see these things because they are eternal. But therefore, we have to set our minds on things that we see that are temporary. You see, that is why Paul calls this a good fight. You don't have to give up. You have to fight it to the finish. You have to run this race with seriousness. You must set your mind on heaven. If you do not do that, hey, that will be great regret. 1 Peter chapter 2 from verse 11. 1 Peter 2 from verse 11. Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, as strangers, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good words which they observe, glorify God in day of visitation. How can we set our minds on heaven? That's a big question. How easy it is to set our mind on heaven? With all the busy world we are in, with all the sad attractions, with all the gadgets and all those electronics and all those fun in life, all those enjoyment, how can we set our minds on heaven? It's a big question. And I get the answer from the Bible. One, limit the pursuit of wealth. Anything that will take your focus off heaven does not worth it. Hello? Let us limit the pursuit of wealth. Limit it. There's nothing wrong to have it. But when those things have you, you are in trouble. You will not be able to focus. When money have you, you are in trouble. When material things have you, you are in trouble. You will not be able to focus. It's going to keep you busy. 1 Timothy chapter 6, 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 6. Now godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with this we shall be content. That is a normal situation. Are we truly content after eating and putting something to cover yourself? It's a race, it's a battle. We are fighting it. We are not, many people are not. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Verse 10, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness, and beheld themselves through with many sorrows. Now look at Paul's advice to Timothy. And that is the same advice I'm giving you. If you are really going to focus on the things that are above, if you are really going to pursue heaven, look at verse 11. Are you with me? Look at that verse 11. Say, but you, O man of God, tell somebody, oh, you, O man of God.
You, O man of God.
No, don't tell the woman, man of God. You tell the woman, oh, you, woman of God.
And pursue righteousness,
godliness,
faith,
presence of many witnesses.
Lay hold on heaven. Tell somebody, lay hold on heaven.
Lay hold on heaven.
Lay hold on eternal life.
Lay hold on
heaven. Don't let it drop from your hand.
Don't let it drop from your hand.
Keep it. Keep it. So at the end you can say, I have kept the faith. Paul said, I have fought a good fight of faith. I have finished my race and I have kept the faith. And say the crown of glory is waiting that will that cannot be corrupt. You see, let me tell you something. Much wealth and money are not going to save anyone. On the last day, much wealth and much money, much material things are not going to deliver anybody on the last day. You know, it's not gentle. It's not gentle. And that's why we must not pursue it with all our strength. We must pursue heaven and control those things. Don't let them control you. Not even from dying. Material things, money, wealth, it's not going to save anybody. Even not even from dying. You know, I was told, I had a pastor just passed. A pastor just passed in Nigeria. From reliable source, they said the pastor, after he passed, in his compound, in his yard, he got 10 cars or 10 vehicles, various types, and two semi, they call it semi here, we call it trailer, at the back home. Two trailers, two semi, packed 10 cars. Listen, he was not a car dealer. Now, if he's a car dealer, it's a different story. Maybe you buy it or sell it. Oh, yeah, that's his business. You have to survive, right? But packing 10 cars, two semi, now he died from the level source, the battle begins. Who will hold the cash? The battle is on right now. Somebody want to have it. But you know, usually people don't remember that someone left it. So why are you fighting on it? Even if you won it, even if you won and get all those cars, you're gonna leave it also. If they will not leave it before you leave it. Don't let those things happen. If those things should have us, we're in trouble. I'm not against people buy many cars, okay? But how many can we ride at a time? How many? If you can afford it, it's okay. But look at Psalm 33. Psalm 33 from verse 16 to 17. Those many cars, those many material things, they are not going to save you. On the day of battle, they are not. They were not able to save that pastor. Verse 16. No king is saved by the multitude of any army. A mighty man is not delivered by great strength. A horse is a vain hope for safety. Neither shall he deliver any by his great strength. That's what I have to pursue. Those things are not going to save anyone. Use them and drop them. Don't let them use you. Amen?
Amen.
Those who trust in wealth, we have bad ending. Those who trust in wealth, oh God. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Those who hold on wealth as if it is the end of everything, they will have bad ending. Just have to learn from this case. Check with me Psalm 49. From verse 6. Those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother. You can't redeem somebody with all those things. No. Nor give to God a ransom for him. For the redemption of their soul is costly and it shall cease forever. That he should continue to live eternally and not see defeat. For he sees wise men die. Likewise, the fool and the senseless person perish. Hello? Are you with me?
Yes.
This is a good ride. Just go along with me. And leave their wealth to others. Their inner thought is that their houses will last forever. That is the thinking of so many people. They think that those wealth will last forever. They think that those houses, those cars, those material things will last forever. They are dwelling places to They call their lands after their own names. This reminds me, you know, back home, there's a street where we live. That street was named after one man. The man is deceased now. They call him Madolani. So when we got to that place, then a Redeemed Church is on that street. So the Redeemed Church wants to name that street Church Street. But Madolani named it, paid the local government some money, and they call it Madolani Street. So the Redeemed Church challenged it. They challenged it because he paid the money, they challenged it. You know what that man did? He didn't fight it. They said, okay, let the church have it. He said, let the church have it. And the church, the name, that street, the name, Church Street. Not too long, that man died. Hello?
Hi.
You see, if that man would have refused, I'm going to fight it. I'm going to take that church. They must change that name. That thing must be my name. So that my children can know that I have a street in Lagos. No, he didn't fight it. It's done. Now, what difference will he make in his life if they call it his name after he had departed? What difference? No. There's no difference. There's no difference. It's not going to make any difference. Look at what that place is. They call their lands after their own names. Thinking it's going to be forever. Nevertheless, man, though in honor, does not remain. He is like the beast that perished. Why do we have to focus on all these things? Why can't you? Look, let's focus on heaven. Let's give our best for the Lord. Spend your time for the Lord. Spend your good health to honor God. Spend your material things to honor God. Amen? Just focus on heaven. Let this race be a successful race. This heavenly race, let it be a successful race. Verse 13, this is the way of those who are foolish and of their posterity, who approve their sayings like sheep, they are laid in the grave. Those who are foolish will be listening to what I'm saying now and be saying, what is this man saying? Finish on time, I'll give you 30 minutes. Summarize. You don't summarize, I summarize myself. I go. You don't summarize, that is your problem. I'm going to summarize and I'm going to go home. But it's not the best thing. We must be the doer of God's word. All these things we are listening to. Listen, God is not going to drop and talk to you. He's going to talk to you through his ministers. Focus on heaven. Pursue heaven. Two, if you pursue heaven, make it a goal to please God in all that you do. If you open the memoir of your life, as we are now, if you open the memoir of your life, how many pages will you have there that we say something about your relationship with God? Remember, Christianity is a relationship. How many pages in the memoir of your life will have something to say about God? How many pages? Some of us, if you open the memoir of our life now, 90% of those pages in our memoir will be those who have offended us. He did this to me. I have written it down. I'm going to get back to him. If it's going to take me 30 years, I must give it back. All those people that wrote them something, they will put everything there. They will focus on all those things. They will not enjoy the peace they have. Brethren, we just have to do something. We just have to focus on God. We just have to focus on an eternal place of rest in heaven. We just have to put our mind on things that are above. 2 Corinthians 5. From verse 9. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done by in the body, whether good or bad. The third one, labor not for those things that perishes. I'm telling you how you can, we are discussing on how can we, you know, focus, or how can we place our mind on things that are above. So the third, I have given you two. The first one I gave you, I said, limit the pursuit of wealth. Anything that will take your focus off heaven does not want it.
The second goal, I gave you the second goal as this. If you pursue heaven, make it a goal to please God in all that you do. And this is the third goal. Labor not for those things that perishes. When we labor and work for those things that perishes, they will not allow us to put our minds on things that are above. John 6:27. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on it. When you focus and put your mind on things above, then your labor is on things that will not perish. It's on the food that will not perish. Because Jesus Christ designed that way. Then the contentment will be the key. When you have your mind set on things that are above. Then Jesus was teaching in Matthew chapter 6. He said, do not lay up, from verse 19, do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So if you put your treasures or everything here, and you want to set your mind on things above, it is not true. It's going to be very hard. Because where your treasure is, that is where your heart will be. Amen?
Amen.
Number four, run with certainty. Run with certainty. So to set your mind on things above, what will help you to do that, to focus on heaven, will be to run with certainty. Be sure that what you are doing is gainful. Be sure that this is a race that is worthy. Apostle Paul called it good fight. That this is not a useless fight. This is a fight that is sure that when you win, a crown of glory will be given to you. 1 Corinthians 9:26, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Thus I fight, not as one who beats the ear, verse 27, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. So if we are sure and we run with certainty, then we'll be able to discipline ourselves, then we'll be able to, you know, to limit the pursuit of wealth. We limit it. Rather, we make an occasion and a place for God in our program in life. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
I think I'll just stop on number five, and then we can continue the C aspects maybe next week. Said, fear him. No matter what I say today, if you do not fear God, it will make no difference or bring any change. It will not bring any change. If you don't fear God, all that I'm saying today is useless. Because there will be no wisdom. You know, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, right? And when there is no wisdom, how do you apply all this thing I'm saying? Because proper application of knowledge is all wisdom, right? So if you don't fear God, there will be no wisdom. And if there's no wisdom, then you are not applying these things you are hearing. Check with me, Acts 10:35. But in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. If you fear God, you will work righteousness, you will take into recognition and into consideration everything I'm telling you now. If you fear God, you will adjust your program, you will shape all that you are doing, you will look at where you have excesses, you will look at where you are going above the bound, and then you will make right adjustment to fit the plans of God, your destiny, heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28. Look at what he said here. He said, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Amen. With reverence and godly fear. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, the issue of heaven is certain. Eternity with God, for those that have accepted Jesus Christ, is certain. It cannot be shaken. Bible says the word of God is settled in heaven. No one can change it. Even if we refuse to take that choice of accepting Jesus Christ, it's not going to shake it. God has a plan for it. It is sealed. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace.
with reverence and godly fear. If we fear God, we will obey Him. We follow His voice. Then it will be more prominent for us to set our minds on things that are above. If we fear God, we want to do His will, we want to do the right thing. If we fear God, we want to listen to His words, we want to put this into action in our lives. We shall continue this next week. We will see the C aspect, something better awaits all of us that follow Christ. Something better awaits us. And that's why we have to take the issue of God's word seriously. Something better awaits us. We shall continue from this next week. The Bible tells me in 1 Corinthians 2:9, even he said, but as it is written, I has not seen, nor hear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. For those who love God, for those who will obey Him, for those who fear Him, for those who put into action all we are hearing now. Something greater, something better than here has been prepared for all of us.
Amen.
We must not jeopardize that great place with all these temporary things we see in this world. All these temporary things. These things we see, they are all temporary. They come and fly. You know what the Bible says about money? It has wings. You can fly anytime. You can fly anytime. But heaven has no wings. It cannot be shaken. It is settled. If you have given your life to Christ, you will have a place of rest with God. No one can shake that. God has already done it. It's done deal. Father, we thank you this afternoon. Bless you, worship you. We honor you because of the place Jesus has come to prepare for us, that where He is, we shall be also. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the eternal rest that you have promised us. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him will not perish, but have eternal life. We thank you, Lord, we ask for strength to pursue that eternal life. We ask for enablement to pursue that eternal life. We ask for grace to pursue that heaven in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, precious Holy Spirit. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen. Amen.